Good evening. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library. As we begin tonight, I would like to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. Here in Seattle, these are the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders past and present and thank them for their stewardship of this land. Welcome to tonight's program with Josephine Ensign, presented in partnership with Elliott Bay Book Company. We're grateful to our author series sponsor, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, and to the Seattle Times for generous support of library programs. Thank you as well to the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Private gifts to the foundation from thousands of donors help the library provide free programs and services that touch the lives of everyone in our community. I have a couple quick announcements before we get started. Our friends over at Elliott Bay Books have copies of Josephine's books, and the store is open for limited browsing, curbside pickup, or delivery. And you can find Josephine's books at their website, elliottbaybook.com. And I'll put some links in the chat as we get going with the program too, so you can just copy and paste that right out of the chat. I also wanted to let you know we have closed captioning available tonight. To access the closed captioning, just click on the icon at the bottom of your screen. And after tonight's conversation or discussion, we'll have time for questions from you. You can ask your question at any time by writing it in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. And finally, we'd love to hear from you. So toward the end of the program, I'll post a link to a survey in the chat and would appreciate it if you took a minute after the event to share your thoughts with us. Now I'm delighted to introduce tonight's speaker. Josephine Ensign is a professor of nursing at the University of Washington School of Nursing, where she teaches health policy, public health, and health humanities. She's also an adjunct professor in the UW School of Arts and Sciences Department of Gender, Women, and Sexuality Studies. Ensign scholarship focuses on health and social inequities for people marginalized by poverty and homelessness. She's worked as a family nurse practitioner for the past 3 decades, providing primary health care to homeless adolescents, families, and adults. Also a talented writer, Josephine Ensign's essays have appeared in a number of outlets, including The Sun, Front Porch Journal, Silk Road, Electric Literature, The Examined Life Journal, and the Johns Hopkins Public Health Magazine. Ensign is the author of several books, her medical memoir, Catching Homelessness, A Nurse's Story of Falling Through the Safety Net, was named the American Journal of Nursing's 2017 Book of the Year for Creative Works. And her second book, Soul Stories, Voices from the Margins, was published in July 2018. Josephine's here tonight to talk about her new book, Skid Road, On the Frontier of Health and Homelessness in an American City. Despite enormous wealth, or perhaps because of it, Seattle has the third highest homeless population in the United States. In 2018, an estimated 8,600 homeless people lived in the city, and often the stories of these marginalized folks are not included in official histories of a place. In Skid Road, Josephine explores how a large, socially progressive city like Seattle has responded to the health needs of people marginalized by poverty, mental illness, addiction, racial, ethnic, or sexual identities, and homelessness. Drawing on interviews and extensive research, Josephine shares a diversity of voices within contemporary health care and public policy debates. Informed by her own lived experience of homelessness, as well as over 3 decades of work as a family nurse practitioner providing primary health care to homeless people, Ensign offers a compelling look at the historical roots of poverty and homelessness, the worthy and the unworthy poor, and the role of charity, health care, and public policy in the United States. Please help me welcome Josephine Ensign. Hi, Josephine.
Hi, thank you.
Thanks for being here.
Yes, thanks for having me. And thanks everyone for being here this evening. I definitely want to thank the Seattle Public Library and also Elliott Bay Book Company for making this event possible. I utilized in pre-pandemic days and in research for this book, used the Seattle room at the Central Library for a lot of my research. And I miss being there. I look forward to returning there someday soon. So as you heard, and if you're not from Seattle, it's important to know that Seattle, even before the pandemic, was one of, it had at least the third highest, if not even higher, rates of homelessness in our country, behind New York City and San Francisco. And we do know that because of the pandemic and related kinds of issues, that the current homelessness situation here in Seattle and King County is very serious. It's grown considerably, especially in terms of visible homelessness, tent encampments, and also people living in their vehicles, vehicle residents. Not surprising that homelessness is the number one issue for voters in the Seattle and King County area coming up on our November election. And what I want all of us to recognize and remind ourselves that homelessness is considered a wicked problem. And that means that it's complex, it's multifaceted, and it causes a high degree of conflict because there's little agreement on the causes, much less its solutions. And then specifically for homelessness, besides being a wicked problem, it's even more wicked because of the social exclusion and the stigma that surrounds homelessness and all of kind of the attending kinds of issues that come with that. I like to remind my students and even myself that when we hear anyone use the phrase these people or those people, to really try to pause and wonder what is behind that, because usually that is, again, kind of the social exclusion and distancing people and stereotyping them. The research and writing for Skid Road has convinced me of the importance of having a deeper understanding of the history of health and homelessness in any city, and especially in our own city and region. And I really believe that it informs the existence and planning and implementation of better policies and programs. So in tracing back to the first official homeless person, that's who I'm going to tell you the story of tonight, that's also in the opening chapter of my book, Skid Road, that it's important to recognize that the Duwamish, as we've, the land acknowledgement, that Duwamish and other Coast Salish people who have called this area home for generations and who still call it home, were excluded early on in kind of settler colonialism from any of the official counts, like the censuses, as well as being worthy of even being considered a pauper or a homeless person. The Washington Territorial Poor Law was enacted on May 1st, 1854 by the Washington Territorial Legislature. And it stipulated that the boards of the counties within Washington Territory were responsible for taking care of the poor in their respective counties. And poor people were defined as being people who are unable to earn a livelihood in consequence of bodily infirmity, idiocy, lunacy, or other cause. And these poor laws in Washington Territory and then in Washington State stayed on the books pretty much unchanged until the middle of the 20th century. And the poor laws were adapted from the English poor laws, and first adopted by the 13 colonies of what became the United States, and then in the Western expansion, adapted to different territories and states. The other thing that you need to know that I think that I actually know that a lot of people are surprised by is that our original poor laws used the contract system, and that meant that the officials of like the county, including in King County, auctioned off poor people to the lowest bidder. And that's obviously rife with abuse and was finally changed. So I'm going to read to you a little bit of the opening from the chapter, first chapter, Brother's Keeper. And what you need to know is that when this chapter opens in 1854, Seattle as a town was barely 2 years old. And at most it had 50 residents. Of course, many more indigenous people who were not counted at that time. Sleet slashed horizontally across the beach, encrusted piles of seaweed, kelp, and driftwood on the high tide line. It worried its way through the flaps of a tattered canvas tent nestled between charred tree stumps and on to the muddy, rag-wrapped feet of the shivering man lying inside. Wood smoke mixed with the salt of the inland sea, fir sap, and rotting shellfish accompanied the hard wind. Late December 1854 in Seattle was relentlessly cold and wet. The man's tent was the only such structure on this stretch of shoreline along the northern edge of the pioneer settlement. The land had been newly claimed by William Bell, but was known to both white settlers and indigenous people by its Coast Salish name, Babequab, Little Prairie, which referred to its stretches of low-growing, berry-producing salal. Piles of clamshells surrounded cedar longhouses built by Native people. The beach here was rich with butter clams and had long served as an indigenous seafood processing area. The tent dweller was Edward Moore, a 32-year-old sailor from Worcester County, Massachusetts, who had stayed behind in Seattle or was left behind by his ship's captain. Perhaps he drank too much even by drunken sailor standards, although there's no record of that. What is known is that he'd been living in his makeshift tent for months, living off raw shellfish he foraged and being cared for after a fashion by the Coast Salish people who lived nearby. Soon after this December day, Edward Moore was deemed by the white pioneer leaders of Seattle to be insane and incapable of taking care of himself. They likely found him in his tent, unable to walk, and carried him along the frozen, muddy beach at low tide to the town's one rooming house. There was no hospital. Upon unwrapping the rags covering Moore's feet, it was discovered that he had severe frostbite. The town's first doctor, David Swenson Maynard, promptly amputated most of Moore's toes with an axe. This was, after all, a frontier logging town where medical care was scarce and sharp axes were plentiful. Doc Maynard may have sterilized the axe with a whiskey he was fond of drinking. Moore survived this primitive surgery and was cared for by Doc Maynard, Maynard's second wife and Seattle's first nurse, Catherine, and the German immigrant innkeeper, David Maurer. Edward Moore was King County's first official homeless person. What became of Moore, how the residents and leaders of the nascent town of Seattle dealt with him, and the poignant story of his final days echo lessons and dilemmas that are with us still. So piecing together various sources of information about what happened to Edward Moore after he was found, we know that he was cared for in Seattle for 4 months, mainly by Doc Maynard. And then in May of 1855, he was transferred to Steilacoom put in the care of Dr. Matthew P. Burns, transferred over from the care of Doc Maynard. And we know from Dr. Burns that he saw fit to shackle Edward Moore to his bed. That was unfortunately very common, as well as other kinds of activities in terms of dealing with people with mental illness back then. Then in late 1855, King County officials sent the Washington Territorial Legislature a bill for $1,659 for the care of Edward Moore. That included the care that Dr. Burns was giving him. And we know that the Washington Territorial Legislature considered it, and they wrote kind of a letter saying that it should affect all of the finer feelings of people in terms of his plight, but that they didn't want to set a precedent for paying for his care. And also the fact that the bill actually was more than the Washington Territory had taken in that year. And various accounts and letters from people, people that were living here, the settlers, indicate that Edward Moore most likely was a victim of a pretty spectacular shipwreck right outside of Seattle before he washed up on the shores of Seattle. And so this, in terms of like a significant trauma, we don't know if he had pre-existing mental illness, but all the different descriptions of him do not indicate that he had any kind of drinking problem or that he was violent at all. And it's most likely that he had a combination of schizophrenia, what we would consider today schizophrenia, as well as post-traumatic stress disorder. So when the Washington Territorial Legislature declined the payment, Dr. Burns was a bit upset by that, decided he would just ship or by canoe, have Edward Moore return to Seattle, to King County. So Edward Moore returned here to Seattle in early January of 1856. And if you remember your history of Seattle, that was right before the Battle of Seattle. So most likely, townsfolk probably bundled up Edward Moore and had him stay in a blockhouse during that battle. After that, it appears that he became just living on the beach again in makeshift structures and trying to forage for whatever food he could find. He appears again in official records on June 7th, 1856, when King County auctioned off the care of Edward Moore to the lowest bidder. And it seems as if either there weren't enough bids, people didn't want to take care of Edward Moore anymore, or the bids were too high. But by late summer of that same year, townsfolk took up a collection and bought Edward Moore a new set of clothes and also paid a ship's captain to take him back to Boston and to Massachusetts to his family. And all of the kind of official accounts of Edward Moore, official histories of Seattle, including Murray Morgan's excellent book, Skid Road, have that as the final say in terms of what happened to Edward Moore. And I was long fascinated by the story, kind of a fragment of the story of Edward Moore, and wondered what had happened to him after he was shipped back to Boston. And it took me several years and actually the help of an amazing librarian and at the Worcester County Public Library in Massachusetts, who helped me to track down what happened to him, or at least more of his story. So Edward Moore did return to his family in Massachusetts, and he was living in Ashburnham. He lived with his sister and his family, as well as his elderly parents. And we also know that Edward Moore had been born on January 28th, 1823, in Worcester County, Massachusetts, in the village of Boylston. Don't know if I have that pronunciation correct, even though I lived in Boston for a while, which is less than 30 miles from Ashburnham. An interesting kind of side note here is that the librarian and I and some other kind of people helping with that research could not find any evidence that Edward Moore was institutionalized at what was then our country's best insane asylum, which the Worcester County Insane Asylum. But we do know from his death register that he died only a few years after being shipped back home from Seattle. His death register records his date of death as being May 12th, 1859, and the cause of death was suicide by hanging, cause insanity. He's buried beside his parents in a cemetery on Meeting House Hill, just north of Ashburnham. He died at age 36. And another kind of side note for this is that Edward Moore supposedly had a wife, Rebecca, and children with her, but it does not seem as if he was living with her when he returned to Massachusetts. And that could be because of the stigma of mental illness at that time. So what I want to do now is kind of bring us back to current situation, like what is the story of Seattle's first official homeless person? What does that have to do with anything that's going on today? If a modern day insane pauper like Edward Moore had been found on the Seattle waterfront in Belltown with frozen feet, Medic One fire and paramedic workers would have whisked him up Profanity Hill to Harborview Medical Center, where he would have received medical care for his frozen toes with something better than an axe sterilized with whiskey. He would have been watched over and cared for by highly skilled nurses. Moore would have received a psychiatric evaluation and appeared in mental health court, where a judge would decide if he needed involuntary confinement to a state-run psychiatric facility like Western State Hospital. Hospital social workers would have attempted to find and contact his relatives in Massachusetts to see if he could be reunited with them. Moore likely would have received, or at least qualified for, after hospital care in the supportive medical respite program associated with both Harborview and Public Health, Seattle and King County's Healthcare for the Homeless program. He may also have qualified for a Housing First program with supportive care. This trajectory assumes that all parts of the safety net in Seattle were intact and coordinated, a best case scenario that works for far too few people. So the story of Edward Moore, to me, highlights some important lessons that are very much with us today. The first one is the very clear link between trauma and homelessness. Trauma, significant traumas often precede and contribute to homelessness, including childhood sexual abuse that has not been adequately dealt with and through good counseling. And then the situation of being homeless, being without a safe place to live, is itself traumatizing, not to mention the exposure to violence and elements that happen when somebody is homeless on the streets. So that, you know, again, I think for Edward Moore, we don't know if, you know, like what his childhood was, what his traumas were, if he had pre-existing schizophrenia or mental illness, but it does seem like both the situation of living in, you know, this makeshift tent and eating raw shellfish on the Belltown beach, that was traumatic, and then also the shipwreck, as well as living through the Battle of Seattle. The other lesson that I think is really important is the need for what Dorothea Dix, a nurse and a mental health kind of pioneer who was a contemporary of Edward Moore, called seasonable care. And that means the early identification and effective treatment for mental health and substance use disorders. And that's something that we really don't do a very good job on in our country. And it's definitely a problem in Washington State, where we still have some of the nation's highest rates of serious mental illness, alongside the access, the poorest access to quality mental health treatment. And of course, that's being addressed, or at least beginning to be addressed. And the other one is the moral and legal duty to care for those that are less fortunate, and all of the controversies, the ethical as well as political ones that are still going on. The other kind of side note that is important to me to note, both with my lived experience of homelessness as a young adult and working with many people, including young people who have survived, gotten out of, and are really thriving adults in terms of homelessness, is the importance of not equating homelessness with permanently damaged goods, and thinking that just, that's the stigma that goes with you. I am kind of heartened by the fact that in Seattle and King County, there's an increasing emphasis on having people with lived experience of homelessness be not only at the table, as kind of token participants, but actually leaders of efforts to address homelessness. So my Skid Road book is part of a much larger public scholarship project that includes a reader's theater, educational materials, and a growing collection of educational videos. So I want to invite you, if you're interested in kind of more contemporary issues and looking at the situation of homeless, especially for people with the lived experience of homelessness, next Friday, that's October 29th, through Jack Straw Cultural Center, I will be showing a video that I recently made called Listening to Skid Road. It was with the public historian, Lorraine McConaughey, as well as the local filmmaker, Jill Friedberg, who served as story editor. And this is, the film is based on a collection of oral history interviews that I did with people that are both working and living at the intersection of health and homelessness. So I would encourage you, that's a free virtual event. And finally, I want to give some kind of brief acknowledgments that the work for this book was made possible through a US-UK Fulbright Award for research on the English Poor Laws, the National Endowment for the Humanities, Humanities Washington Four Culture Heritage Awards, and the Jack Straw Cultural Center. So thank you, and I welcome your questions.
Thanks so much, Josephine. Thanks. That was really interesting history, and then I loved how you tied that to current situation. So I'm going to invite folks that are watching now to ask your questions by popping them in the Q&A box. It's at the bottom of your screen, and then I will sort through those and ask them for Josephine. So far, there are no questions yet. I think people are maybe they're absorbing some of what you've said. I did have a question. We did get a factual correction from my statement at the beginning that King County, not just Seattle, has the third highest homeless population behind mm-hmm. New York City and LA. So I just wanted to thank Greg Scruggs for that, and then mention that I, misspoke at the top of the event. So I'm seeing from Stacy, is there a way we can up talk about tiny houses and other ways of increasing affordable housing? So would you like to take a minute to chat about that? I know that's not your specific area of expertise, but do you have thoughts?
Yes. Well, and I get into that in the book, specifically a chapter called Shacktown, and hearkening back to the Hoovervilles during the Great Depression here in Seattle. And the Hooverville just south of Pioneer Square was our country's largest and longest lasting Hoovervilles. or Shacktown. And there are a lot of, there are differences, but there are also similarities in terms of the current tiny house villages. I've worked in some of them in terms of healthcare, worked with residents. And to me, like putting myself back into kind of, especially being a woman in homelessness, having a door that locks is hugely important. So in that way, I think it's an improvement over congregate shelters, as well as informal or formal tent encampments. They, for the most part, have shared bathrooms. You know, it's kind of a FEMA trailer with shared bathrooms, as well as a shared kind of kitchen tent area. And they can help to build community as well, which is very helpful for people, you know, with social exclusion and homelessness. I personally don't like thinking of them as a permanent solution to housing, to permanent housing. I mean, they're super small. It's like living inside a shed. And just the kind of human dignity and what all of us have probably experienced during the pandemic. We now really know firsthand, right? The link between housing and health. And so I would like to see maybe that as kind of a temporary stopgap kind of a solution, but not as permanent, either permanent supportive housing or permanent housing. So the other thing that is starting to be talked about and addressed in Seattle, we have one of our country's highest rates of land that is zoned single family use. Mm-hmm. And we know with, you know, racial restrictive covenants, including in Seattle, the intergenerational wealth transfer that happens from home ownership that has, you know, privileged white people in Seattle, that having changes to those, the single family zoning is, I think, a step in the right direction to really look at, what are they calling it now, neighborhood something or other. There's a name change at city council to try and start looking at that and beginning to have multi-use, multi-family housing as well. Mm-hmm. And then there are also discussions about how, like, kind of innovative solutions or programs for people who are renters to start to accrue some type of equity, so that they're not just, you know, paying out their own money to housing. So those are all, I think, important issues that are beginning to be addressed.
That's great. Thank you for that. We've gotten a lot of questions just while you were responding to that first one. Okay. And there's some really great ones here. So John asks, what sorts of proposals are being discussed currently regarding improving our region's capacity to care for those with mental illness?
Yes. So I was in a meeting earlier today with Frank Chopp, our mighty representative, state representative from the 43rd district, who's working on this. He's been a big proponent of expansion of mental health services, and he was instrumental in having more funding in the last legislative session to have, for instance, a behavioral health unit built at UW Medicine at the Northgate Northwest site. And that's going to be both expanding inpatient and outpatient treatment options for people with mental illness, as well as training not only physicians, psychiatrists, but also kind of close to my heart, psychiatric nurse practitioners who have prescribing abilities and are hugely important in rural areas, underserved areas, in terms of mental health treatment access. So that's going on. Also, Harborview, the expansion of, what had been the nurse's home, Harborview Hall, which was utilized during the pandemic for isolation quarantine for people that, without homes, with either exposure or illness with COVID. And there's money now to expand the psychiatric inpatient and outpatient facility at Harborview, which, of course, you know, that's our main hub in terms of access to mental health treatment. So those are efforts that I know are going on, as well as recognizing again that housing, and not transitional housing, because that, mm-hmm. especially for families, for children, but also for single adults, that is not good in terms of trajectories for mental illness and stabilization. So of having more kind of permanent housing available in different formats.
Okay, that's great. Thank you for that. So we've got some kind of big picture questions I thought maybe it would be helpful to start with. One person is asking, actually, how do you define homelessness? And I think this gets at one of the things that I think you were talking about, or maybe I read it on your website, about not everybody is being counted, right? Mm-hmm. And so can you talk a little bit about how you define homelessness for the purposes of the work that you're doing?
Right, the work. Well, there are official definitions, and actually two kind of differing federal definitions of homelessness, mm-hmm. which is always interesting. And then down to like the county level for the point in time count, you know, the count mm-hmm. us in that, mm-hmm. of course, got paused during the pandemic. So we don't mm-hmm. have anywhere near an accurate count. They're hoping, you know, to have that again this coming January. But, you know, it's really like what you kind of talk about, literal homelessness, which is like in an emergency shelter, in somebody living like vehicle residence or tent encampments, that's kind of literal homelessness. And then there's a lot more what we call hidden homelessness, which kind of includes people in encampments that, you know, are purposefully staying away and trying not to be seen, vehicle residents as well. And then especially for homeless teens and young adults, which is a population close to my heart that I've worked with for a long time, it's much more likely for them to be couch surfing. Like they have housing instability. Our students, we have, you know, University of Washington students who are homeless, literally homeless, as well as couch surfing. And for many of us who work, you know, in homelessness, we consider that homeless as well, even though it's not on official counts considered literal homeless.
Okay, thank you for that. And the other kind of bigger picture question that I think Valerie is asking, could you share your thoughts about the things that go into making King County number three for homelessness in, you know, and also Valerie says, P.S. I've just started the book. It's beautifully written and I'm looking forward to reading the rest of it.
Oh, thanks. Make me cry. Okay. So that's a really excellent question. And I would push back a little bit on the comment. Because Seattle, it's hard kind of comparison, right? Because LA, it's like LA County, huge. But Seattle itself as a city has one of our nation's highest rates of homelessness. And the interesting thing is, as I found out through the research for this book, is that we have had one of the highest rates of homelessness of any region in the country from the very beginning of our city. And if you think about the history, logging, fishing, you know, sailor, you know, like Edward Moore, it was like people coming into kind of temporary and also seasonal industries with, you know, the flux of that. They're also very traumatic. I mean, people had all sorts of nasty injuries. And then, you know, they were disconnected from their families of origin. You know, most of them were, you know, back east or wherever, or from other countries. And so that disconnection and the industries that were happening from the very beginning in Seattle contributed to high rates of homelessness. Also, Seattle has always been almost like literally the end of the line in our country. I mean, when the railroads were built, it was literally kind of the end of the line. And so people moving here in that whole kind of westering, I love that word, of, you know, go west and, you know, find your fortune, the gold rush, or just finding a job, that's happened from the very beginning. And it continues to happen. I mean, people migrate here now, you know, for jobs, for opportunities. I've had many patients, you know, the vast majority of homeless people experiencing homelessness in Seattle and King County first became homeless within Washington State somewhere. So they're not like coming here. It's not a magnet.
Right.
You know, right. We're feeding the pigeons, I hear, you know, kind of thing.
I've heard that myth.
Yeah. Services. That's not the case. But, you know, I have had many patients that have moved here, moved to Seattle and, you know, from Mississippi, Alabama, and from poverty and using like all of their, like their family and friends, you know, giving them a collection to move out here with a promise of a job that then falls through, you know, whether Amazon or Microsoft or, you know, startups or whatever. So, that continues to happen. And then of course the insanely and still rising cost of living as well as cost of housing here.
Yeah, that actually leads to, let's see, a good question. How do you integrate conversation around mental health / trauma into housing policy, particularly since housing tends to be discussed through an economic lens? So I think.
Yes. We were having this discussion today in a group with Frank Chop. And I like to try and talk with people about, and I think more people are hearing this term if they haven't before, the social determinants of health and of health equity. That, you know, we think that access to healthcare, access to mental health treatment, those are important, but they actually have a lot less impact on our individual and population health than we would like to think, like between 5 and maybe 15%. And the rest of it is a little bit of individual, you know, behaviors like smoking and drinking, whatever. Mm-hmm. But the vast majority is really caused by the social determinants of health, which is everywhere, everything that is in terms of like where we're born, where we grow up, go to school, work, age, and everything else. So that includes housing is a huge component. That's a big social determinant of health and of health equity. So, depending on the person I'm talking with, right? Because I just had a conversation with my students this morning about this because the topic was social determinants of health. But of getting that across, and I think, again, going back to the pandemic, which is just literally brought home to all of us, the importance of the link between home and health, which is really important. And the other thing that I do want to say, because you hear more people, more advocates using houselessness instead of homelessness. Mm-hmm. And I understand where they're coming from with that. I push back on that because from my own experience, from working with people experiencing homelessness, from the research, it's not just a house. It's not just a physical structure. It's all of the emotional, like, you know, my stuff behind me, my books, you know, my family. It's everything, and my community connections. It's everything that makes that house a home. That's really what is important, I think, in terms of addressing homelessness.
Thank you. So we have several questions asking if you're comfortable sharing a little bit more about your lived experience of homelessness, if you're comfortable with that, and how it compares to what you see on the street today. And if you're not comfortable with that, that's okay. We can move on. There are plenty of questions.
Hey, I wrote a book about it. So yeah, comfortable with it. But I will say with that, because I talked about the social exclusion and stigma of homelessness, mm-hmm. I was not comfortable talking about my experience for a long, long time. Mm-hmm. My family, and my closest friends, maybe, but not my work, my University of Washington, everything else. Mm-hmm. And that's because, you know, people stereotype and stigmatize, like, what was wrong with you? You know, and what, mm-hmm. you know, what did you do that caused your homelessness? So I, and obviously my situation, you know, I'm a white person. I was working and living in the South in Richmond, Virginia, which is my original hometown. Working with people in healthcare, doing a healthcare for the homeless clinic there, and I, in my mid-20s, and had a lot of unaddressed kind of childhood trauma that I had not gotten adequate help for, and then also was working for an organization that had ties to Jerry Falwell and the Christian right. This was like in the 80s, you know, with the whole thing. And I had clashes as well with the minister who was actually running this about, for instance, counseling people who had HIV/AIDS to get them to confess about what caused their HIV/AIDS before they died. And I was like, no, or also about abortion, you know, access to abortion. Mm-hmm. So also kind of a worldview thing. But the mental health and a really serious depression. So I spiraled into homelessness, mostly kind of vehicle resident, living out of an abandoned shed, couch surfing. So that's again why I think it's so important, especially for teens and young adults, to include that for about 6 months before I basically did my own Greyhound therapy and got out of Richmond, Virginia. And moved to Baltimore to go to grad school and got access there to really good therapists. So that's, and so, you know, I talk about this even in my book. I recognize my own privileges. I mean, you know, I was white, I am white. I came from, even though it was a problematic family, in my childhood, you know, parents that valued education. I had a good education. I was already a nurse and a nurse practitioner. So I had a lot of advantages in terms of kind of overcoming that many people do not have.
Right.
So,
but that also goes to show how thin the line is though. Right.
Right.
So
right.
You have that privilege and we're still in a position where that, you know, that ended up happening with you. Right. Mm-hmm. And so it's good that you're acknowledging that that's privilege, but it also, I think, illustrates how thin that line is between, right. you know, how easy it is for somebody to become homeless.
Right. And it's not equal opportunity. Right.
No.
But,
no.
And people, you know, persons of color, people growing up in poverty, you know, have a lot more overrepresented in terms of homelessness.
Right. Yes. Or folks that are, you know, have sexual identities that are, or
exactly.
Are transgender, you know, right.
Yes.
Absolutely. Well, thank you for that. I don't know if I let you get to the part because I interrupted, but did you get to the part about talking about how that compared to what you see today?
What I see today. I still work with especially young women who have similar kinds of experiences. I mean, that's not something that could only happen in Richmond, Virginia in the 1980s, right? I mean, those kinds of things I've had. People having breaks with their faith. I've had clients who grew up in very, in the Mormon faith, or any kind of faith, and have had kind of breaks with that, different worldviews, but also kind of like, you know, the traumas that haven't been adequately addressed that happen as well. You know, parents with their own mental illness issues as well as substance use disorders that where they're not getting access to help themselves, much less, you know, to keep their families together. The foster care system, which we know is important, does not always work for our young people. And we have amazing people here, Jim Theophilus and the Mockingbird Society, that have done a lot of work, and Frank Chop also, in terms of extending the care for people aging out of foster care mm-hmm. and all sorts of things like that.
Excellent. Thank you for that information. We have a couple questions that I think go together. One is, what percentage, and you know, I think they're asking for an estimate if you know, what percentage of the homeless population in Seattle suffer mental illness? And do they get assessed for that problem, receive counseling treatment if they want it? And I'm sure that answer varies, but do you have a sense based on your research?
Yes, that, and it's, you know, it's a common, I think a common misperception that people who are experiencing homelessness are mentally ill and or have, co-occurring substance use disorder treatment or disorder. And the experience of homelessness is destabilizing for even the healthiest, mm-hmm. Mentally healthy person going into it. And again, the trauma that has also probably preceded homelessness. So, and it will also depend, like if you ask a psychiatrist, I mean, this has been going on since the 1980s and estimates of mental illness, et cetera. If you send psychiatrists out, they're going to think everybody is mentally, I'm sorry, I love psychiatrists, but it's going to be overdiagnosed, I think.
Okay.
PTSD is a mental health diagnosis. Depression is extremely prevalent. And then obviously also schizophrenia as well. And again, knowing that schizophrenia is oftentimes, there are genetic issues and other things with us, but that trauma can really trigger it.
Absolutely. Well, so another question is asking, is there a way to help people who are refusing treatment or refusing housing? This anonymous attendee says, like you, Josephine, I've been homeless and found many people I came in contact with who are still homeless and refuse to seek housing, regardless of whether they're on the street or living in their vehicle. I'm in housing, but know many who could have housing but refuse to pursue it.
It's a really good question. And there are going to be people who refuse. My perspective on that and kind of experience with it is that there's some disconnect in terms of trust because I really do think it's a human kind of a thing to want safe housing, if it's affordable, if it's something, in a place that they can trust. So that's where, again, outreach workers and people working with folks over time to develop that trust. And that's where I think the navigation team in the past here, if it was police, that's automatically not, difficult. Wonderful people, but right. Difficult trust. So I think that over time of using people that are trained in harm reduction, motivational interviewing to meet people with where they're at, of what they want out of life, and then helping them to kind of move incrementally at their own pace. Kind of pace for it. Yeah, mm-hmm. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. So you kind of alluded to this, and I think a couple folks in the questions have asked this. So Lauren says, not to get too political here, but are there any policies that the mayoral candidates are pushing for that you're optimistic about?
Yes. Well, and I widen that to city council and things like that as well. Mm-hmm. I think, and at first I was kind of skeptical, I didn't really understand all of the issues and how single family zoning related to, discrimination as well as current homelessness. And as I've done more research into that, both for the book and the wider project, I'm really convinced that is an issue that needs to be addressed. And so we know some of our candidates are taking that on directly. And also expansion on programs that we know work of getting people, we used to try to do transitional housing, and now doing much more kind of permanent supportive housing, the housing first model we know works. And that's not just, I mean, we've had 1811 Eastlake around since 2005 for chronic inebriates. We know that works, but it's also been expanded for people with chronic mental illness. And then it's also being used, like the Gates Foundation had a big kind of nationwide study, but also in our area, of homeless families and getting them, instead of transitional housing, housing readiness that we used to do. You have to earn, you have to act a certain way to, you know, earn housing, of getting them into permanent housing actually really helped. We know, you know, what King County and Seattle has have done during the pandemic of buying the hotels, motels, getting people their own rooms with supportive services, including healthcare services, that actually has had really excellent outcomes, not only in terms of reduction of, you know, COVID infections and deaths, but also qualitative research you know, shows people have just, you know, that's helped to increase their stability and also their mental health just by itself, and also a sense of community without the drama of shelters.
Right. Yes. The drama. Well, so related to that, I think, you know, in terms of the candidate question, Nicole says, you mentioned that homelessness in Seattle is a huge concern for voters, but NIMBYism is still, or NIMBYness is still a sizable problem. And can you talk about effective strategies you've seen or might recommend for getting members of the public on board with services in neighborhoods?
Yes. NIMBYism is alive and well in our area. So, I mean, I really do, although I have some questions and things like that, but programs like Facing Homelessness that, you know, they do the whole, I forgot what they call it, but like, yes, in my backyard, right? Mm-hmm. Of having like a community say yes to having a formerly homeless person live in a tiny house in somebody's backyard, and the entire kind of community buying into that and having discussions and working with them. And I mean, that's small scale, but I think that programs like that can really help. And also for people to get to know somebody who has experienced homelessness or who is currently experiencing homelessness, get to know your real change vendor as people instead of just, again, those people, I think can really help.
Right. Realizing they're human. Yeah. So we actually have a follow-up question to your comment about the single family housing zoning, which I think could be interesting to dive into if you have thoughts about this. So this person says, I agree a change is needed for density necessary to house more people. But what I see in Ballard, for example, is single family homes demolished for three or more expensive condos. I'm not seeing that density filled with affordable housing, but maybe that's just my neighborhood. Could you speak to that? And I live in West Seattle and we see the same thing here.
Right. Yes. Ballard, it has had that issue. So, yeah, I mean, you know, real estate, you know, it's so lucrative for people that own real estate, that's going to be a pressure. And that's, you know, why in terms of the candidates listening to what they have to say, of having kind of more mixed income and having incentives for developers to include that so that happens more often than just, or even like what happened at Yesler Terrace with you know, our country's first racially integrated public housing torn down, you know, Paul Allen, mixed income, but displacing hundreds of low income people. So that is something to always think about.
Yeah. Like you said, it's a wicked problem.
It's a wicked problem. Yes.
Yeah.
It is.
Yeah. Well, we have time for just a couple more questions. And I'm sorry, we're not going to be able to get to everything. This is obviously a huge, huge issue. So I do want to, there are a couple folks that are asking, first of all, if this talk will be available on your Facebook page. And what I can let folks know is that that the library is recording this talk, and with Josephine's permission, of course, and we'll be captioning it for accessibility, and then we'll post it on the library's YouTube channel. So if you go to YouTube and just look up the Seattle Public Library, we have many of our author talks are archived in the author events playlist, and Josephine's will be in that playlist. It normally takes a couple weeks just because we have a lot of stuff in the pipeline all the time. and if you are interested in knowing more, you can always contact the library and I can let you know when the talk is posted. And then we also have questions about your event with Jack Straw. I put the link to the Facebook event in the chat so folks could see that. But folks are wondering if the resources that you will make available next week are going to be available on your website, or will it be available elsewhere after the program?
Right. No, thanks. And yeah, this talk will not be on my Facebook page because I don't have Facebook. but thanks for recording it, making it available through the library. That's excellent, especially with the closed captioning. The event next week is through Jack Straw. It does. It's free, virtual. They just like this, ask for a pre-registration. And it will be recorded and shared on the Jack Straw website, and also the film that we'll be showing and then having a discussion on next week. Listening to Skid Road is already available on my YouTube channel, along with other kind of 5-minute educational videos on different topics related to the Skid Road book and project, including the single family zoning.
Oh, that's great. And so would that be at your website? Could they find more information on your website /Skid Road? Is that the right link?
Yes.
Okay, great. I'm going to pop that in the chat right there for folks. Yeah, that's great. So folks can keep up with what you're talking about. So we have time for basically one more question, I think. And several people asked this, and an anonymous attendee said, I'm in high school. I help in a food bank and with donations. How can I support homeless people that I see all the time? And we have several questions from folks asking that basic question, saying, what's the single biggest thing I can do to help? Should I donate to a national organization, give money to people locally who ask for it, volunteer my time? So do you have thoughts on that you're...
I do. Yes. I think that the first thing, and kudos to who's already doing that in terms of the food bank and how, food insecurity, which is huge, growing problem. The thing that I say is to treat people as people. Like if somebody asks you for a handout on the street or wherever, please don't ignore them. Try to look them in the eye. If you don't want to, or you don't have something to give them, say, no, sorry. The worst thing behind calling them names is ignoring them, because it's like they're, again, invisible people. If you're in the Seattle area, I really encourage you to buy and read Real Change and to get to know the vendor. They're not necessarily people experiencing homelessness, but they've had lived experiences in terms of poverty and homelessness. And so get to know them as people. And then also find an organization locally that aligns with your values, and either volunteer, get the money, do both. And also, especially if it's an organization that does both direct service and also upstream, advocacy and policy work, to try and address homelessness on this larger societal and systemic level, I think. And then there are also, the National Alliance on Homelessness. You educate yourself on it. The National Healthcare for the Homeless Council, if you're interested, or your healthcare worker, has excellent resources and trainings as well.
That is great. And I'm so appreciative of that. And thank you so much for your time tonight. This has been really, really enlightening. And it's such an important conversation. And I appreciate the historical lens, but also, how that lends context to where we are right now. So thank you for that. For folks watching, Elliott Bay Books, our partner on this event, have copies of Josephine's books, and I put links in the chat for those books. And the store is open for limited browsing. If you're on Capitol Hill, you can pop in and say hi. You could also do curbside pickup, or you can order books for delivery too if you're not feeling like you want to go out of the house quite yet. And so you can find books at their website, elliottbaybook.com, or like I said, I popped some links for Josephine's book specifically in the chat. And we'd love to hear from you about tonight's program. So we're posting a link to a survey in the chat, and I would appreciate it if you took a minute after the program to copy and paste that into your browser and let us know what you think. I'm going to pop it in there right this second, so you can just take a minute and copy and paste that or click it, and it will open a little survey that will take you 2 seconds to do it. We're so grateful to everybody who made tonight's program possible. Thank you to our program partners at Elliott Bay Book Company and our sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, the Seattle Times, and the Seattle Public Library Foundation. And of course, thanks to everybody who joined us tonight, who asked wonderful questions. And thanks so much to you, Josephine. Thank you for the work that you do in this realm. It's so, so important.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, everybody. Have a wonderful evening, and go see Josephine next week at Jack's. Yeah. Okay.
Bye.
Good night.